Good evening and welcome. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to the first session of what I'm sure would be a great conference on airport landscapes, urban ecologies in the aerial age. Of course, I want to thank all of you for being here, all the speakers and people who've traveled very far and wide. We are also very happy that this event coincides with the ASLA weekend, and I'd like to welcome all of you who are visiting for the conference. And this day also coincides with the visit of our Alumni Council, and welcome to all of you for being here. I want to extend my thanks to Professor Charles Waldheim and Professor Sonia Dumpelmann, who have been working very hard together for many, many months on the exhibition and also on this conference, which, as you know, is primarily dealing with the transformation of a great number of disused airports into new forms of landscape. Charles will be introducing the conference, and so I'll leave it to him to tell us more about the context and the organization. Just a few thoughts, because I think this idea of the airport landscapes, in some ways also separately from the themes of the exhibition and the conference, provides an opportunity to, for us to really think more broadly about the status and role of airports and the way in which they have an impact or influence the field of landscape architecture and vice versa. Many of us are used to traveling and visiting many airports, and it's not very uncommon to arrive at an airport, get out of the plane, walk down a corridor, go down a set of escalators, catch a train, arrive at the immigration office, go through customs, having picked up your bags, and then catch another train and leave the airport and go through a series of tunnels, and it's only probably a few minutes later, when you are well and truly away from the airport, where you might begin to have a sense of light or a sense of what might constitute landscape. It seems that for many of us, the experience of the airport is actually an experience of being cocooned, not of seeing anything of an outside, but of the experience of pure interiority, of a pure inside in some ways. The topic itself of this experience of the airport has, of course, been discussed many, many times, and the most sort of infamous text on this is the one that you all know by Marc Auger on the concept of non-places in the book that he wrote as the introduction to the anthropology of supermodernity. We also know from George Clooney's experience in Up in the Air that perhaps airports are not as much of a non-place as Marc Auger would have us to believe, because there is actually a very specific kind of place that takes place at the airport with its own very precise organizational structures, hierarchies, lounge after lounge, the ones that you can't get to, and the whole way in which that hierarchy is organized actually creates a very specific and precise set of relations within this place of non-place. But when you travel, actually, for me at least, one of the most sort of exhilarating experiences of airports is the experience of traveling at night. And when you are arriving at a place and you begin to see the lights of the city. And if you're lucky enough to actually see the lights of the airport and the runway, and the fact that the airport itself is completely dark, but there is, in fact, a landscape, but that's the landscape of the lights. And the way in which illumination, in some way, begins to produce a very specific experience of the terrain, in some ways. It seems that we don't pay enough attention to this idea of the landscape, which is really the landscape of night and the landscape of light. And I think one of the most beautiful experiences of the airport also as a place of light is in Michael Mann's movie of 1995, Heat, where, for those of you who haven't seen it, I'm going to ruin the ending by showing you a tiny snippet of this film where Pacino and Robert De Niro are having their final encounter at LAX, on the borders of LAX. So bear with me. Can we show the video? Technology. So what I thought is so exciting about this is that actually the experience of LAX is both the experience of the way in which the lights at the airport are working to help produce, in a sense, the background to the film, but also the way that the landscape itself is lit by the airplane. So the airplane itself, through its movement, becomes part of the temporal moment of just lighting a portion of the airport just for a very short period of time. These scenes, in some ways, speak also of the manner in which the concept of evocation, of evoking a certain condition, not just representing it in terms of its material situation, but actually through the way in which lighting produced, in some ways, a temporal condition of LAX becomes quite relevant, in the sense that I feel in the many of the projects that we're engaged with, we could learn a great deal from precisely this experience of the temporality of the airport and the plane and the lighting of the landscape, as a way to actually begin to think about the formation or the making of the landscape itself. There is, of course, I think, even a kind of bigger project, which we won't go into, because this will then go outside of the realm of an introduction, that really the whole idea of the aeroplane or airport and dealing with the phenomenon of air in the sense of taking that also more literally, also leads us to begin to think about this relationship of the airport as a component of turning the whole experience of what has been called as the heavy turned into appearance, and the essential now dwelt in lightness, in the air, and in the atmosphere. I'm sure that these are a lot of the themes and topics that in some way engulf the project of airport landscapes with the making of landscapes And I'm certainly looking forward to seeing and hearing how this project evolves over the next day or so as we hear the various presentations on this topic of airport landscapes. Please welcome Charles Waldheim.
Thanks very much, Mohsen, and thanks to all of you for coming out this evening. For those of you that are uncomfortably up there on stairs, there are a few chairs down here in the front. If you want to join us down here, you're more than welcome to. It's particularly interesting also around the ASLA annual meeting to see so many old friends and new colleagues join us this evening. Airports have never been more central to the life of cities, yet they remain peripheral in design discourse. This is our postulate, at least, to begin a question. In spite of this marginal status, we claim that landscape architects have recently reasserted their historic claims on the airfield through a range of practices. The Airport Landscape Project represents these practices both in the exhibition and in the conference following. And we hope to convene a discussion around the idea of the airport itself as a form of landscape. Many of you know that over the last decade, the airport has emerged as a central case study for those of us interested in landscape urbanism. Equally, I would assert that over the last 5 years, it's emerged as central to the project around ecological urbanism. Certainly, the airport has been relevant to the school's recent interests in landscape infrastructure, its interests in projective ecologies. And at the same moment, those of us in the academy, I think, have an obligation to continue responding to what's happening empirically and on the ground with respect to new ideas, new theories, new modes of practice, new methods of work. In practice, landscape has been found useful as a lens for reading the airport across a variety of media. These include a range of projects. You see some of them in the exhibition outside. They include highly publicized, highly influential, let's say even now quasi-canonical projects for Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam or Downsview Park in Toronto, Hellenikon in Athens. What's been less well reported are a range of smaller projects, projects for Floyd Bennett Field in New York, or for small restoration wetlands in Northern California, or small public parks in New England. We now have a body increasingly of built work of these projects that you can see many examples of which are in the exhibition, most of which are coming from Western Europe or Scandinavia. The German and the Norwegian examples, I think, are particularly interesting. And at the same moment, in recent years, we've had exhibitions and conferences and competitions organized in Iceland, Morocco, Ecuador, Taiwan, a range of international venues. Airports occupy pivotal positions in the geographies, the economies, and the ecologies of the cities that they continue to shape. Yet for me, in spite of this centrality, the airport occupies a kind of cultural blind spot. This is a blind spot for me that's characterized by forms of categorical confusion. In this regard, I feel that there's a concomitant confusion with respect to the design disciplines and the academy. Who practices on the airport? Who professes to the airport are among the questions we're asking. Into this void, our postulate is that landscape architects have reasserted their historic claims over the last decade or two. And at the same moment, our position is that this reemergence of landscape productivity in the space of the airport has been under-theorized, with a few notable exceptions. While it's been certainly possible and at times productive to think about the airport as a site for architecture or even a fragment of urban form, my position, my argument would be that the relentless horizontality and evacuation of human occupation, Michael Mann notwithstanding, of most of the airfield combined with this ongoing operation masks the ability for architecture or urban form to really deal with the contemporary airport. In that context, of course, the desire to cover, conceal, one might say even camouflage the airport in traditional architectural or urban form reveals this conceit. In this context, the void of the airport reads to many as a kind of emptiness, and this emptiness then produces in itself a kind of urban vacuity. At the same moment, this relative lack of recognizability produces for us in this building and in these professions that we work in a relative lack of clarity. In this regard, the status of the airport in design reminds me a little bit of Michel Duchateau's invocation of the dying man for the physician. That is, it falls outside the thinkable. It falls outside the limits of what one can do. At the same moment, the unrecognizability of the airport is amplified by the fact that airports are planned most often for sites as far away from the cities that they serve as possible. And yet they quite often come to form the center of their metropolitan area. That fundamental contradiction produces increasingly a set of voids and emptiness in what had been the center of the urban field. Of course, in this regard, the airport has been taken as a surrogate for the city itself by many. Mohsen's already invoked Marc Auger's non-lieu, the non-place. 3 decades prior to Auger's formulation of the non-place, the Dutch artist Constant argued that, in a well-publicized lecture of 1966, quote, "The airport of today can be seen as the anticipatory image of the city of tomorrow, the city of man passing through." And in this regard, there is a reflexive relationship between the history of the airport and its future and the future of urban form. At the same moment, we'll see many such examples over the course of the next 24 hours as we've assembled an extraordinary cohort from around the world across disciplines to speak to this topic. Having said that, the intellectual history of the airport taken as a landscape is a little murkier. Of course, my colleague and collaborator Sonia Dumpelman sheds quite a bit of light on this in her work in the exhibition in the Loeb Library and her forthcoming book on the topic. At the same moment, in contemporary practice, I think we need to do more to articulate the methods and the modes of work in which other disciplines and landscape architects might engage. We're hopeful that over the next 24 hours we might consolidate that topic and ways of thinking about it. As I've looked over the last couple of years at the intellectual origins of the idea of, you know, airport as landscape, for me one of the most resonant moments was found in the writing of Alvin Boyarsky. So before Alvin was the chair at the AA in London, he was working at the University of Illinois at Chicago. And in the late 60s, early 70s, wrote a few pieces, including this one reference to Chicago's O'Hare as Chicago's Versailles. Boyarsky described it as, quote, "an inspiring diagram, speaking the poetry of flow, an unheralded masterpiece descended from such giant prototypical installations as the stockyards, the pier, the service tunnels, soldiers' field, etc. It recalls, for Boyarsky, the generic style of the city itself." And in that regard, I do think there's something about the modern project of city making and the modern optimism around the airport that we might look back at. More recently, of course, we have the cultural geographer Dennis Cosgrove's piece from 1999, Airport Landscape. In this context, Cosgrove proposed to view Heathrow Airport as itself a kind of landscape. And he qualified that he said the airport may, quote, "be a space that initially seems to lie well beyond the conventional understanding of what constitutes a landscape." And I think that's true, and it's also fair to say that Cosgrove's piece tended to focus primarily on a landscape gardening tradition that seems quite distant from us, even though it was only 14 years ago. Cosgrove went on to argue, maybe more productively, that he was not really concerned with design issues. He's not really concerned with landscaping the terminals, the runways, or the public open spaces, but rather with conceiving the airport itself as a complex, functional, spatial, and to some degree, visual whole. And for that, if we take Cosgrove's definition of landscape, he juxtaposed his words with paintings, and that he required a visual medium through which to understand the airport. In that context, as Sonia and I began planning for this exhibition about 2 years ago, it was central to our project to begin by claiming the airport as a cultural site. Before it's a technical or an architectural problem, before it's an engineering or an urban planning problem for us, to claim the airport and the airfield itself as a site of cultural production. And so you see outside a range of 50 photographs by 10 photographers from around the world. In particular, we're using the work of Jan-Arthus Bertrand, the Parisian aerial photographer known for his environmental photography, and the work of the American Phil Underdown to invoke the operating airfield and the decommissioned or airport afterlife. We juxtaposed those images with a series of film clips, including Michael Mann's Heat and a range of other images from film and video that try to invoke the airport as a way of understanding it as a landscape. These objects are juxtaposed with a range of other artifacts, technical, cultural, and biological. The main body of the exhibition includes 32 case studies organized around operations and afterlives by a range of designers across cultures internationally. And underlying all of that is the principle that landscape architects have reasserted their role in the airport site, in part because of their facility with ecology as a medium, both a lens for thinking about the airport, but also a medium for intervening upon it. In that context, we're of course interested in the managing of the biologic function of the airport, the idea of the non-human actors, and at the same moment that the airport is a place that gathers such an interesting and often surreal context of so many different objects. It's been really interesting to see over the last couple of days since the exhibition opened to see our little faux coyote gain such Instagram popularity. And I can tell you that's the most often asked question is, what is this coyote doing? We have a real biological object. We have an actual 19th century peregrine falcon from the Natural History Museum, which of course, Sonia will tell you, predates motorized flight. And at the same moment, the faux coyote is a more authentic object for our purposes curatorially, because of course that's the object that airports are purchasing and placing around their airfields to manage bird strikes and other things. In that context, of course, the Dutch robo-bird drone falcon that it's next to is maybe the 21st century equivalent of that management process. In some ways, we're hopeful that in addition to welcoming you all here around this weekend, we might be able to, at least for a moment, claim that landscape historian and critic Mark Tribe's invocation of Gundahl as the airport has finally come true. In the late 90s, for those of you that know Mark or know the culture of the GSD, we regularly have visitors from around the world here teaching. And happily, Mark found himself visiting in 1997, I'm told. And he's the origin, I have it on good report, of this vernacular usage of Gundahl as the airport. Not so much the operating airfield, but rather all of his colleagues and friends scurrying to and fro with their luggage on the way to or from Logan Airport. I would be remiss if I didn't conclude by my brief introduction without doing two things. The second will be introducing our speakers. The first will be to make some brief acknowledgments. Thank you, Mohsen, for all of your support for this effort and for landscape architecture more generally at the school. I can't tell you how proud I am to be on a campus in which the university president, the university provost, and the dean of architecture can articulate publicly and very forcefully the centrality of landscape architecture to the university's mission. Thanks to Pat Roberts and to her team for all of their support for this project. Sonia Dumpleman agreed to co-curate and co-convene this with me 2.5 years ago, and that predates her appointment at the GSD. This will give you some indication of her commitment to the topic, her character. About 2 years ago, we began the process that would finally recruit her to join the faculty, and so what I want to leave you with is the sense that this is very much the product of a collaboration in all senses of the word, and that Sonia is disproportionately responsible both for the sharing of the intellectual content, but also for getting us here today. So Sonia, thank you so much for all the work that you've done. I'd also like to acknowledge Ben Prosky, our Director of Communications, and his team, of course. Dan Borelli, Director of Exhibitions. I want to acknowledge David Zimmerman Stewart in the exhibitions shop for all the work that he's done. Chantel Blakely in events, Ronnie Saroff, Communication, many, many others. I'd also like to acknowledge Sienna Scarf. Sienna Scarf Design did all of the image identity for this project, all of the emails, all of the posters, all of the material in the exhibition is her work with respect to design. Our research team included students and recent graduates Dalal Al-Sayer, Azura Cox, Fadi Masood, Connor O'Shea, and a number of faculty who contributed on the curatorial side, Bobby Pietrusco, Nasheed Nabian, Alan Sayeg, Sylvia Benedito, Luis Callejas, Kelly Duran, and many faculty who are contributing to the show itself, Pierre Bellanger, Anita Beresbieta, Chris Reed, Luis Callejas, and Elko Huftman. Of course, thanks to all of the designers who contributed work for the exhibition. Thanks, of course, to all the speakers that traveled so far for the conference. Tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., Sonia will make some brief introductory remarks and introduce Adrian Hoos, our third keynote speaker, tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. Our second speaker this evening will be Christophe Giraud, my old friend Christophe Giraud. Thank you for being here. It's so nice of you to come. Christophe, as you know, is professor and chair of landscape architecture at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, the ETH Zurich. He's also there the founder, among other things, of the Institute for Landscape Architecture. Christophe completed his graduate work in both architecture and landscape architecture at the University of California at Berkeley, and he has been previously professor and chair of landscape at the École Nationale Supérieure de Paysage in Versailles. Broadly, we could say that, among other things, Giraud's research deals with landscape perception and analysis, particularly new media. He's interested in contemporary theories and histories of landscape, and most recently, new or emerging methods of landscape design, and his formulation of the topological is something that I would invite you to pay attention to going forward over the next couple of years. He has received an astonishing array of awards and recognition internationally. He's taught at a range of international venues, including the Graduate School of Design here at Harvard. He has exhibited internationally, including work in the MoMA Groundswell exhibition. And what's maybe more pertinent for our purposes this evening, he has been, over the course of the last several years in his teaching and in his research, engaged in the airport as a central preoccupation at various moments. He's going to give a talk entitled Wild Plains and Airfields, an Allegory of 21st Century Landscape. Our first speaker is Dr. Peter Gallison. Dr. Gallison did his doctoral work here at Harvard, where he now serves as the Joseph Pellegrino University Professor and also as Director of the Collection of Historical Scientific Instruments. Gallison is an international figure in the history of science and technology and has, among other many awards and honors, received the MacArthur Foundation Fellowship and the Max Planck Prize. Among other things, Gallison's work is interested in how scientific and technical subcultures form languages, in particular with respect to theory and objects of study at their margins or borders. In this context, his monographic books, How Experiments End, Image and Logic, among others, are now canonical. For our purposes this evening, we may be more interested in his interest in questions of representation and design culture. In that regard, I would give you Objectivity, a book focusing primarily on how visual representations play a role in questions of proof or objectivity in sciences. He has, of course, co-edited volumes on both architecture of science, but also picturing science and producing art, and is co-editor of a volume that's been particularly important for Sonia and I as we thought about this event, Atmospheric Flight in the 20th Century with Alex Rowland. Perhaps not coincidentally, Gallison is also a pilot. He's written quite a little bit on aviation and the forensics of aviation disasters. We're very fortunate to have him with us this evening. Please welcome Peter Gallison.
It's a great pleasure to be here, and I want to thank Charles and Sonia for including me. Much of my work recently has been about questions of land, a very different kind of land, about what happens when nuclear materials are boxed in, or we try to box them in, or they get out. And so I've been spending time in Fukushima and nuclear weapons plants at the places where we bury nuclear waste, and trying to understand these bizarre spaces that are sometimes the opposite of what you might think. For example, the Savannah River nuclear weapons site is now one of the densest places to find alligators. Now, they're radioactive alligators, but they're alligators nonetheless. And what starts as a wasteland twists around itself to produce a kind of waste wilderness that occupies spaces that we thought of previously as on disparate ends of the spectrum from purity to defilement. What interests me about airports is that they aren't just what they seem to be, that they are more than the perimeter fence that defines them, the chicken wire or barbed wire that cuts off the nominal space of the airfield from the world around it. And what I want to do today is to suggest that those of you in landscape architecture and all of us interested in these questions have in fact stumbled upon a space that is a play of scales, constantly oscillating between extremely local phenomena and regional ones. In fact, the question, is an airport a place at all, goes deep in philosophy. Martin Heidegger famously decried airplane hangars as being buildings, not dwellings, the kind of thing in which he was exactly not interested. They are built, but never for dwelling. Marc Auger echoes that sentiment when he calls the airport a non-place, a generic space, one where we never live, residing out of memory, a part of that super-modernity. I want to argue that these have it backwards, that we actually are living in an airport, properly understood. Logan, which I'll focus on most directly, can be seen in this, the cluster of runways here and the buildings that support them. And at one level, the airport boundary just surrounds the boundary of land and sea and then cuts around behind those terminal buildings. But it's more than that, more than the behind the fence. Now, airplanes, the conduct of flight, and airports all reflect a construction by accident. And I mean that in a quite literal sense, that the way we build airplanes is constantly being modified by the disasters that accompany them and the procedures in an airplane. For instance, you can't speak in a cockpit after you go below 10,000 feet because an airplane had a pilot and a co-pilot chatting away as they plowed into the Everglades some years ago. And after that, the doctrine of the sterile cockpit was established, so non-flight discussion was forbidden anytime below 10,000 feet. But in many ways, all of the procedures on the ground at an airport, or the marking of high towers, all of these things come from accidents that then lead through the investigation of National Transportation Safety Board to recommendations that then alter the physical structure, the height of buildings, the orientation of runways, and so on. And I want to talk about that radiant effect of the regulatory and physical and safety concerns that are constantly expanding what actually counts as an airport. And you can see that as you go beyond the airport diagram itself to look at a map of, say, the Boston airport, and you already see it's given as a region. And these concentric circles, which I'll describe more closely, this is a chart for visual flight rules, where you're not flying by instruments and where there are regulations that define exactly what conditions in the atmosphere constitute visual flight rule acceptable conditions. But as you see, as you come in closer and closer, the restrictions get more and more severe. And there are zones of exclusion, zones where you have to have your transponder on, zones where you have to be in positive radio contact with the tower, until you actually end up on the runway, and then a whole new set of procedures are invoked. If instrument conditions prevail, Boston looks like this. Traces in the sky given by focused radio beams that guide you along a specific trajectory. That's now being expanded and modified by GPS, but still the instrument flight rules are also in a region, and you've probably had the experience of being in an airplane where the pilot says, we now begin our approach, we're 100 miles from Boston. And so in some sense, already in the actions that are taken and the flow of the planes, these routes are determined 100 and sometimes more miles out from the perimeter fence. In regulation, the airspace over a typical airport looks like an inverted wedding cake. And this is a kind of architecture in the sky that has very severe demands at each of those levels and typically will go up to 10,000 feet before the airport ends. So the airport actually is 2 miles high in a regulatory and communicative sense. In that zone, you're constantly supposed to be talking to air traffic control when you're farther out to TRACON, which constitutes the communication with planes en route. And as you descend in this cone, this wedding cake shaped into a kind of a geometrized cone, you come in closer and closer to the airport and are subject to ever more restrictive rules as the airspace is more closely defined. On the ground itself, at the end of a runway, is called the runway protection zone. This is at Logan on runway 22 left. Those numbers correspond, 22 means pointing in the direction 220 degrees, so southwest. And in the runway protection zone, up where you see the highlighted green, bright green area, that whole area was depopulated to satisfy the protection needs of planes coming into that runway. And the runway protection zone sets out restrictions that don't just affect the airplane's behavior or conduct, but also what you can build there, how high you can grow trees. There was a crane on a barge that was part of the shipbuilding effort over there in Winthrop that was taken down because it violated the strictures of that runway protection zone. Some of the houses on the left side of the protection zone, you can see the red line on the left that encompasses a group of houses there, those are subject to easements and restrictions about how high they can grow trees, about what kind of activities can take place that have electronic noise associated with them, about how high the structures themselves can be built. And in fact, there are charts like this one, an example version of what's called avigation restriction. I've flown for years. I've never, until preparing this talk, seen the term avigation, but it's navigation except no water. So it's avigation restriction. And you see these numbers here on the side as you go acrossways are restricting the height of structure of where the structural boundaries are. And you can see then it'll have consequences for where the tree cut line will be. So it begins, the airport itself, far away from the actual fence, already gives you restrictions on the flora that can be there, the human-made objects, buildings, and behavior in terms of electronic and other forms of potential interference with flight. Cranes like this were the ones that were taken down. And you see, this is a rather beautiful chart that is included in Sun-Yun Charles's wonderful exhibit, and it's called a chart of critical surfaces. And it shows you these contour lines, show you essentially the restrictions on how high buildings should get as you come closer and closer to the airport. So what you're seeing here is actually a set of recommended, and in some cases required, restrictions on what you can build. And the airport, the folks at Massport made this chart so that they could communicate with builders and architects as they began to consider the wider construction within the city of Boston and surrounding areas so that they could tell at a glance at least when they would be in a problem zone of height construction. And that would then advance the discussion that then would go back and forth between the airport, the FAA, and the builder. Sometimes it has a purely a very direct effect. For instance, this is at the back of that runway protection zone. The before is at the bottom where you see the gas station, and after it's been torn down and made into an empty field. Or this simulation, which was made again to show to builders and architects what the flight path was, and often the pilots would be flying in instrument conditions, and they could see from this what it meant for restricting building heights as you went off the runway and up over the city and then into the routes that the planes would be flying. So again, the airport is moving out over a region and shaping in regulatory, sometimes optional, sometimes not, structures that govern how the city begins to form. There are also structures, these sky structures, these regulatory sky structures that are evanescent. They come into existence and they come out of existence. An example might be Camp David, where you have a restricted area that when it's occupied by one of those, becomes a prohibited zone. And actually, under no conditions and under no, you can't even request permission to overfly it, whereas in a restricted zone, you could request that. So the zone itself is transformed. Then there are places that are always prohibited in the sky, places like the nuclear submarine base at Kings Bay near St. Mary's, Georgia, or Nellis Air Force Base, AKA Area 51. And the pilots speak of the box, and here's a visualization of that box, where they say, from the ground to a height of unlimited, you're not allowed to fly. So these sorts of structures exist around airports, and in this case, far beyond the 10,000 feet, because they're launching missiles, for example, and you don't want to be above them. They don't want you to be above them either. Then there are evanescent structures, evanescent not in the sense that they're evanescent in the world, or modulo some Italian cruise ships, but for instance, in the Inner Harbor, you have these cruise ships which are the size of buildings that come in. And when they do, you suddenly have something the size of a building at the end of the runway. So this is not good for taking off and landing. So there are Logan and other airports in similar situations had to develop a whole new set of radars that basically looking for ships and tracking where they were, which would regulate the flight patterns of airplanes. The planes themselves also have a noise impact on the area below. And those too have been very influential on the value of property, on the way people live their lives. And you can see here actually that as the rotors in a jet engine get bigger, seen in the very large new planes like the 777 and others, you'll see these very large engines, and those are much quieter. And because of that, the zones of 65 decibels and above has actually shrunk. And you can see, for instance, that the Charles and up towards the North Shore has actually come in quite a lot, and those are successive generations of engines. But that's, again, a way in which the airport shapes architecture, the value of land and housing throughout a region far outside the fence. And then, of course, there's the security scape that we face at the airport. And there is, you know, nothing more local than a TSA person patting you down. But the process, for instance, of global entry, their slogan is, what are you waiting for, is designed to surveil you long before you come to the airport. And on your boarding pass is marked that you have TSA pre, which means they've gone over your vitals and likely intentions before you actually arrive at the airport. So the security check begins when you buy a ticket. And so, again, there's this aspect of close and far, a play of scales that goes from the most intimate touch and checking that you have less than 2 ounces of your favorite shampoo to a virtual check that scans your prior behaviors in a wide range of dimensions. The same is true in the bioscape that surrounds the airport. You might think that the biological problem of controlling, say, deer from getting on the runway was one that was entirely inside the fence. But as we know from bird strikes, that's not true. And one of the most tragic and well-known bird strikes, up to the more recent one on the, near the Hudson, was Eastern 375, which took place on the 4th of October, 1960, when an Electra hit a flock of starlings and within a couple of seconds lost its engines 1, 2, and 4. Sorry that that's cut off slightly on the left. And the plane immediately entered a It was flying too slowly to remain airborne. It rolled left and crashed into Winthrop Bay. There were a few survivors. There are many people who lost their lives. It destroyed visibility on the windshields because where the Starlings had hit, it cracked and they were splattered there. The pitot tubes were ruined, which measure airspeed, which meant they didn't know actually how fast they were going and therefore what it would take to remain in flight. The left wing stalled. There was no lift. It was a catastrophe and was the event that really made bird strikes into a central concern for aircraft safety. This is a picture of the Electra. And from the newspaper at the time, after a bird strike, as you can see from these rotors that are badly damaged by birds, the planes are supposed to be able to survive an impact of a 4 to 6 pound bird, but there are lots of birds around here, like geese, that weigh a lot more than that. And so it's a big problem, and one that actually has gotten worse, not better. The geese impact on flight US Air 1549 that put that plane into the Hudson, again, ratcheted up the concern about bird strikes. For the wildlife control people who handle these sorts of problems, this was a very near miss, but one that they could have seen coming by looking just at the number of bird strikes in U.S. civilian aircraft from 1990 up to 2012, and you see this enormous increase. Now, some of that is an increase in flight, but other factors have brought birds closer to airports as well. And each strike, when they can identify even a fragment of DNA or feather, goes to the Smithsonian Feather Laboratory, and they're then identified, and that can be used to try to sort out what the specific problems are that need to be addressed by the wildlife control people. Here, for instance, is a feather from the strike on that US Air flight that I just showed you. Now, what this means for the airport region is that a whole range from the most local to the regional are implicated in the biological control problem. These Phragmites can't be sprayed because they're, for ecological reason, they're on the bay, so they must be cut. And that becomes a big issue because these provide the environment where birds can nest, but also rodents live. And the rodents then become food for the raptors, and the raptors can be quite large and can be an immediate danger to planes. So this is an example of where a plant and the rodents and the birds are all interconnected. In fact, the person who's in charge of this, the USDA person at Logan, Jeffrey Turner, began his work trying to build up at park sites things like Phragmites because they lead to the rodents and nesting and birds and raptors, and it actually, in the desire to expand the biological range of those areas. And now his job is to do the exact opposite, to use the knowledge that he had to create biodiversity to now create what he calls a biological desert, which will minimize the likelihood of predators like coyotes or of moles that could dig and destroy wiring underneath the runways, or worse, create a collapse of the runway in certain places, causing a crash. So there are a range of burrowing animals, of animals that might become food, animals that could be hit on the runway that could be catastrophic, and then all of the bird life. It's actually a huge range of species that are of concern. And they begin to know what height they fly at, what there are different problems. For instance, regrading Logan was important because the standing water attracted ducks, and the ducks then got in the way of the airplanes. But it also means that for the biological control of these species, the airport is not the airport. It includes, for instance, the Winthrop Golf Course, where a lot of the geese like to go. Now, the golfers don't like them much more than the pilots, but it means that part of the job of the biological control people at Logan is to circulate in spaces that are not on the site. So they spend time out at Winthrop Golf Course, at Suffolk Downs, on the Esplanade, trying to figure out to work with these other areas because the birds don't particularly care about your chain link fence. So again, there's a scale of that goes down to a rodent who might dig under the runway to the whole Boston area when wherever you have spaces where birds might gather. That's true for weather as well. For a long time, pilots have been concerned about the wide-scale weather. And some of them are rather easy to track, like a line of thunderstorms or a weather front that can be hundreds of miles long and move at a nice, predictable pace. But there are also other kinds of weather that are extremely local. And that was, so this is a wide-scale weather. This is a system that you can see goes from Boston down to New York and way out to sea. But at a smaller scale, again, made visible through an accident, on the 2nd of August, 1985, Delta Flight 191 was landing at Dallas-Fort Worth, and suddenly the pilots saw their speed increase enormously, and then they knew right away that they would be suddenly seeing their speed reduce suddenly. And what was happening was that they were facing a microburst. Here's a, let me play this for you, or a little piece of it anyway. Oh, sorry, there's no sound, but anyway, so they were descending, and then they saw suddenly that that the speed had changed. The pilot said to the co-pilot, "We're going to come out of this, and we're suddenly going to lose speed." And that's what happened. And as soon as that happened, they suddenly didn't have enough motion through the air to give them enough lift to remain above. And you're now low and slow, which is the worst possible condition for an airplane. And so they crashed. And that crash, so here's what a downdraft looks like from a thunderstorm. It's this intense, extremely fast flow of air down that then spreads out. And what happened was, as they entered that, they suddenly see an effective airspeed that's very high because the air is hitting the ground and pushing towards their nose. And then as soon as they got past the center of that, then suddenly they've got a tailwind, and their airspeed, their effective airspeed, drops, and they were driven into the ground. And this has led to a whole range of new regulations and new forms of visualization of tracking weather at this microburst scale. To be looking, for instance, here at that zone D over there where you see wind shear, where around an airport, both from instruments inside the plane using Doppler radar and other things, and instruments that are based on the ground, you're tracking weather at a scale of 100 yards or 200 yards, not 100 or 200 miles. So what the conclusion that I draw from this is that we, in fact, contra Auger and Heidegger, actually do live in airports, because airport landscapes are neither bounded by that chain link fence nor by permanent structures. Bioscapes, cityscapes, seascapes, weatherscapes, and etherscapes, the communicative regulatory zones that are established, are all at once physical, virtual, and regulatory. If you penetrate a prohibited zone, you will be shot down. So what looks like a virtual space actually can become a real one rather quickly. All of these things embody and encompass all of these different scales, from the micro scale of the mole's tunnel underneath runway 22 left to the macro scale of a region that's constantly being integrated through regulation and zoning, through patterns of noise, in many different ways into the airport itself. Far from being built but not lived in, the airport runs through the full-on set of scales in which we live, from rodent to region. Thank you. Do you need a dongle?
Definitely.
Okay.
Thank you. Let's see.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real pleasure being here tonight talking about airports in general. I'd like to thanks, first of all, Charles and Sonia for having me here, for having trusted me for this half keynote. And I'll try and explain the title. The title of this talk is really to sort of retrace a fairly short history. We're talking about roughly 100 years of history. 110 of aviation, where things have evolved dramatically, I mean really dramatically accelerated, and the relationship of man to, or woman to the landscape, to the terrain, has also evolved drastically. And in a way, what I'd like to do is retrace through allegorical steps what I understand as being the evolution of this situation. And I'd like to contend that today the problem is actually a very deep psychological, political problem that we have that is deeply connected to the relationship of the building. I'd like to take again what Mohsen described as the phenomenon of arrival and being put through escalators and tubes and trains, the absence of relationship with the terrain, which I think should be explained. So I'm going to do my best to do that in a very short time. It's a bit of a marathon. And I hope that you will bear with me. So the prologue is about the poetics of the airfield and the birth of the avian myths. I have here a few pictures of old tiger moths, of an unsung hero, this French aviator, Hélène Dutieu, an aristocrat, well known for her achievements in early avian history. And of my great-grandfather, Paul Boucabé, who worked actually for counter-espionage in the First World War. And when he lost his spanner, he simply landed his Blériot in the field and recovered his spanner. The whole territory was actually an airfield, like the whole of Canada was an airfield. It's important to understand that. There was a sort of immediate relationship between the human being and the act of flying. Age one is an age of still continued poetic development and adventure. I would say it lasted until the end of the 60s, so it's a fairly long period. And I talk about the Belvedere and the apron. The apron, as you know, is the element in front of a main building. It is actually the forecourt of an airport. I'm going to use basically two main case studies on purpose, actually, Kloten in Zurich and Riem in Munich, for the simple reason that one airport is still actively functioning today as an airport. The other one has been transformed under an urban project. And I would contend that the problem is not so much whether an airport is functioning or not functioning that is at issue for the profession of landscape architecture tonight, but it is much more the sort of process and the way one approaches the question of site. As you all know, I've always believed in traces, trace concepts. I believe that each site has a unique story to tell, and we should recognize that. And I would tend to say that it's more through the failed recognition of those inherent qualities of a place, the given structure of an airport, whether abandoned or functioning, that has led to some errors, in my opinion. Claughton occupies, strangely enough, one marshy area north of Zurich. You see Lake Zurich in the distance, and you see Claughton in the foreground. The only reason why they chose that site is it used to be an artillery training camp, and there used to be a small airfield, an air meadow, like the one of my great-grandfather. And simply for that reason, because the infrastructure was there, Claughton happened to land on this swamp. This is the view of the swamp before it was made. And what's interesting is in the adjacent region, right along the runways today, there's one of the oldest Celtic springs in Switzerland. It's called the Golden Tor, the Golden Gate. There's a legend that a Celtic nymph seduced a young man to go into the water. It's almost like Narcissus. And somehow this young man was resuscitated and shot up in the air, sort of a premonition of its avian future, so to speak. Equally along that site, we have the rest of an old Roman trading post. And look at the sort of mosaic. It's sort of a prelude to the logo of the Swiss airline in itself. When you look at Roman settlement patterns in the area, you realize that Claughton is at least as important as Zurich, if not more so, connecting the Rhine and Schaffhausen with Winterthur and Baden. It was a real cross, so the theme of the cross is definitely there. It's been there for over 2,000 years. I won't go into the detail. Claughton always appeared as a region a little bit beyond Zurich, but still part of Zurich. And if you look at this magnificent late 19th century plan of the village of Claughton, everything in green to the west is actually a swamp. It's called a reed, as reeds in the English language. And the sort of bulge, the white bulge you see in the foreground here is actually an end moraine, the end of a glacier, which is basically where the airport sits today. In other words, there's a logic to the terrain. The terrain gives a logic, a topological intelligence to the way the site is going to be developed. Here's a further plan showing you the same thing, sort of a more conventional cartography showing the extensive swampy area, full of birds, by the way. And this is the first airfield sketch of Zurich Claughton. You see a DC-3 flying over this funny pattern laid down on the dried up lake now, with Lake Zurich in the background, and of course the Alps, not the Matterhorn, but just the 3,000 meter Alps in the background. And this is the first aerodrome after World War II, 1948. Immediately after, with the arrival of jet age, the airport has to change, has to be amplified, augmented. And for that, there's a sort of original sin that happens. Some of the forest, some of the tree stands have to be felled in order to do so. And I'll come back to that sort of original sin because of the ecological mission that has been given to Claughton in more recent years. Again, you see the extension of the airport in the 60s. A beautiful picture where you see a comet from Olympic Airways, a Vickers comet, and Coronado with the little propeller planes in the foreground. This sort of mix of airfield and airport, the apron out of hard material and the grassy field for the more poetic and adventurous flight of the individual. Note also the bugs there that serve as airport vehicles, convertible, of course. And then finally, the extended runway. The golden spring that I showed you is here. This is the Golden Tor. The Roman goods is here. And the airport is at the end, at the tip of this end moraine. All right? So that you can situate yourself. And when you see the view of Zurich, almost like a photograph, it reminds me a little bit of that first plan that I showed you, this early plan showing Claughton up in the distance with its big black forest, the hardwood, which was actually the fuel reserve for the city, and then, of course, the main Lake Zurich with Bellevue in the foreground. Rheim Airport in Munich has roughly, I don't want to say the same, but a similar development. If you look at the original map of Munich, it lays to the west of the city on the road to Salzburg. These are the old salt, Roman salt roads, salt coming in from Salzburg. And Rheim is up here, and the airport is going to get located right here. If you look at a map of old archaeological sites, and more particularly Roman sites, you see also that, again, there's a high concentration of trading posts along that area, particularly in the Rudering area here, south of Rheim. What you see also is a drainage pattern, because this, too, is a post-glacial lake, swamp area, drained, very flat, which has similar characteristics, although here you read it more geometrically. You see the main drainage lines here. And what's particularly interesting when you look at the cadastre of the early 20th century, this is still Rheim, there's a real logic to the main drainage system and the adjacent fields that are actually running perpendicular to that. It's as old as agriculture, as old as the earliest Mesopotamian fields. There's really an inscription in the terrain which in a way dictates, or if not dictates, suggests a way to orient the airfield. And the airfield, effectively, this is an airfield developed in the 1930s in Germany with the Tribune from the Third Reich here in the foreground. You really feel that the old drainage pattern is part of that airport phenomenon. And actually, the shape itself is part of that history. This is Rheim after the Blitz in 45, completely flattened, particularly around the buildings and the Tribune. And then Rheim, until the 1980s, was the main operating airport in Munich, before the new airport, Franz Josef Strauss, at the other end of town, towards Freising, was open, where they had to flatten four villages in order to make that new airport. So Rheim, actually, what I particularly like about it is it's really reacting to a context and actually drawing the best of it. Tempelhof, which is probably the most iconic examples, we're going to have Elke talk about his project tomorrow on that. Right at the beginning in 1933, a few months after the National Socialists came in, before the building was even built, the flags were there and the field was just a grassy meadow without an apron. It was already used as an airfield, and then it was converted into an airport. Very emblematic. Here's sort of a leisurely picture of passengers waiting at Tempelhof in the 30s. And then, of course, the post-war symbolism attached to Tempelhof, which is the celebrated Berlin airlift. Here you see all the goods being loaded on the trucks, a heroic period. So rather a place where symbolically, emblematically, the object itself constructed in the 30s takes on a fully other meaning, fully other character. The plea in this first act is that the airport always involved the human being on the apron or in the role of the Belvedere. Here you see a crowd gathering at the airport in Tempelhof on the apron during an air show. You see a galaxy here in the foreground, an absolutely huge machine. And what's quite fascinating is you realize that it's not just an airport, but it's actually a ground for human gathering and actually a place of cultural meaning. Similarly, if you go back to Munich in the 1940s, you realize that this tribune, the way people are standing orderly in lines because it slightly steps up, were meant really as a sort of viewing arena for the different aerial shows happening. There was a sort of immediacy or an immediate relationship between the viewer, the observer, and the event of the airport itself. You could almost say the same thing about Zurich-Kloten. It was officially inaugurated a few years after it was built in 1953. For Swiss standards, they had over 100,000 people coming there. You can barely see it in the image, but the whole meadow here is covered with people here too, in order to see the newest planes. Here's a constellation, for instance. which at the time was really a sort of a mirror of modernity. The landscape designed by Gustav Ammann, the Swiss landscape architect in 1948, looks almost like nothing. It's just a field with a few apple trees. When you look at the plan, you say, well, look, it's totally uninspired and banal. But the main thing is it's a huge clearing, enabling people actually to occupy that clearing and enjoy the view. It's again a sort of arena. What's particularly important during this first period is that the relationship of the architecture to the outside, the sort of porosity between the inner lounge and the outer terrace, is immediate. It's unquestioned. It's innocent. Here's a picture of how you would get on board your plane as a serious businessman or businesswoman. This almost looks like Maggie, but I don't think it's her. In the 1960s. Look at the relationship. You didn't have to communicate with people on FaceTime. You just had your loved one, or whoever it was, just wave at you goodbye. Very simple, very immediate relationship, very sensual. And when you think about that, there's probably one iconic film above all others done by the English filmmaker Chris Marker called La Jetée, which is actually not a film. It's actually just a set of photographic stills. The theme is horrendous. It's about a Third World War and nuclear disaster. But he uses the jetty, the notion of the airport as a jetty, as a sort of universe in itself where people end up really exchanging and looking beyond. What I like about this photograph taken from the terrace in Orly Airport in Paris is that here the main figure stands against the background of a landscape. The landscape is still there. The airfield is still part of the experience. There is an immediacy between the emotion in that picture and the backdrop against which it is set. This film is sort of a cult film. It only lasts 23 minutes. I have to say it's rather difficult to look at. I'm just using the pictures because I like them. I never managed to go through the whole film myself, but it's a fascinating point because it talks about a period which is almost reaching an end point. It's very fascinating, especially if you pick out the French example of Orly, designed in 1961, inspired by Jean Prouvé, even though it was finally designed by Vicario, where you basically see almost a Versailles-like building, I agree with that, with a central axis here, the road going underneath the main building. It would be the headache of anyone dealing with internal security today. It would be the antithesis of what we would normally do today. You have to understand that it was a completely different period, and in a way, it's the end of the age of innocence. So what, may you say, happened? It's a question to you. Maybe you know. Maybe I should stop right there. I mean, you probably all know intuitively what happened, but I'm here to remind you. And that's why I'm using this rather strange title. Title number two is Enclosure and the Return of the Cyclops. And I start again with a French example. I'm sorry I'm being chauvinistic tonight, but probably not totally against my will. The Roissy 1 Charles de Gaulle Airport, designed by Paul Andrew, his first building, actually, airport building, in 1974, is the antithesis of this. And only 13 years separate the two objects. We politely refer to it as the Camembert today. It is characterized by a total absence of windows towards the outside and a completely internalized cyclopean universe inside. Why? This is also roughly the time, and I don't know whether Andrew ever read Surveiller et Punir by Foucault, but it is the absolute perfect panoptic machine. The idea is the following. No more apron, or the apron is a reserved territory. The passenger is digested in this hole, in this sort of funnel, injected in these concrete pipes, and land in these boxes. Why? Why this shift? Why this distrust with the apron? The entire facade is blind. Autistic, I wanted to use the word atopic, but it's used in medicine. I don't want to use the word atopic, but it is not linked to the territory or to the view. And it's one of those tubes that take you to this time machine at the time, which can take you beyond the ocean faster than the sun moves. You could have two breakfasts. You can reach New York in 4 hours. You have to realize this age. But is that the reason why this building was made in that way? I don't think so. I think there's a real political reason behind that story. There is such a thing as Black September. For those of you that may be of my generation, you remember that. But it's a very, very specific event which happened on September 12th, not September 11th, September 12th, 1970, where three planes, a Swiss plane, Coronado, TWA 707, and a VC-10, a Vickers VC-10 by the BOAC, landed in Jordan, were actually abducted, hijacked, and became the scene of a very strong political event for the Palestinian Liberation Organization under Arafat, where basically the passengers were taken away, men were selected. Few people really got killed. I don't think anybody got killed in that event, but the building, the airplanes got totally disintegrated. A few months before that, a Swiss airplane heading for Tel Aviv blew up in midair above Germany, and actually the sort of psychosis happened. This is 4 years before Roissy. And we have to understand that this sort of evolution of fear, this culture of fear, has had a fundamental influence not only on the architecture of the airport, but actually on the landscape surrounding it and our understanding of that landscape. I just mentioned a few cases in between. Lockerbie, roughly 18 years after Dawson Fields. Of course, the last event, also Avian, which you all know, where monuments collapse and where the dust doesn't only land in the fresh kills, but actually lands on the entire planet. This dust of 9/11 and the whole 30-year history behind that, going back to Black September, has considerably influenced the way we approach our daily travel. And I'm going to use this example. I'm going back to Mohsen's comment about the sort of internalization, this notion that the enclosure has been branded by airports. There's sort of something complacent going on in this enclosure, where ironically, and here I'm showing you very interesting enough, an interior airport interior designed by Malherbe Design, a French interior luxury interior design office for Jeddah 2012, where the moon is reflected on the ceiling, where landscape is a couple of green plants in a bubble, and where you can buy your cosmetics and wares at a global scale within a completely enclosed universe without any kind of reference to the outside. I've always wondered about this evolution where, for instance, I traveled again today, a mineral water bottle, a plastic bottle of mineral water will be considered highly suspect, but if you buy a Dior bottle of perfume or a bottle of champagne, which you could easily smash on an attendant's head, nothing is really suspicious about that. And I find the whole mechanism there, this sort of internalization and branding of airports, has become a machine which, in a way, and I'll try and argue that further, has disconnected us from the landscape and has also, in a way, incited airport authorities not to develop links to the landscape, because in a way, this captive audience, this captive crowd, has to be kept at bay with security measures altogether. So I'm being a bit of an agent provocateur here, right? Act three of Edges and Thresholds. This is Roissy on a warm July day. We're in the eye of the cyclope here. Here you have a couple of people wearing sweaters on a warm July day with plastic trees and plants around. They don't seem to mind. They're within the safe confine of that airport. This is the hole I'm talking about again, right? And this is Roissy today. I tend to think that this sort of model, this type, has developed in other regions. Zurich Airport is clearly one example where the sort of Roissy phenomenon has taken hold. One has to admit that. If you look even at the new terminal, midfield terminal, and its connection underground, even though they play a video of the Heidi yodeling in the Alps, when you're underground, you are actually disconnected completely from the apron. And the, remember that picture I showed you of the passages in the 60s. I'm not saying we should go back to that. What I'm simply saying is this looks strangely like Jeddah. We're everywhere. Jeddah is everywhere. We are actually within this cocoon. Just to further the point, the Circle Building, which is the biggest building to be built in Switzerland by a Japanese architect called Riken Yamamoto, and I find it ironic, his team is also called Field Shop. Field Shop, which to me is sort of an oxymoron in a way, but it's fine. We'll accept that. And it's ecological because the roof is green. But it is actually not a circle, and it's eating the apron, this huge, this is 12 stories. It's eating exactly the apron on which Gustav Ammann set his whole stage. So we're obviously not working together. And it's not by greening things that we work together, it's by opening things up and letting the dialogue happen. What's really interesting, and I think that's really the key point tonight, Kloten is considered the biggest ecological reserve in the greater Zurich region. And you have to understand that it has been sold as an ecological threshold because of a variety of things. For instance, the runways here incited a dialogue with the environmental agencies and movements, which were very strong, and they pushed things to a very extreme stand. The runway was seen as an ecological threat because each time a tire hits the ground, it releases foreign seeds. Goldenrod, Solidago canadensis, is considered by the Swiss as an invasive species from America, and they have 3 permanent staff, year-round, hired to pluck them away from the ecological area that this sanctuary defines. And when you look at the greater region, you realize that what they're selling, and this is actually Flughafen Zurich AG, selling an airfield biotope free of foreign contamination. Now think about it. That is ecology taken to a very high degree of refinement. I'm not joking, this is very serious. Here you have roller hikers enjoying a stroll around the ecological field. Of course, the alpine setting contributes to that. Needless to say, landscape architects are not involved in this project. These are just natural agencies. Whenever we came to Zurich Airport to suggest working on connecting the outer landscape to the building, it was refused for the commercial reasons I've sort of postulated. And if you look, for example, at other places like Frankfurt Airport, which can't afford the ecological sort of control teams that the Swiss do, they broke up a runway at Frankfurt Airport. What I find beautiful is the result. They said, let's just let nature happen. They get a goldenrod allee because all the US planes that have landed there over 30 years. And the real question would be, well, what is the actual role of nature here? I find this much more informative about the history of a place, its traces, than the sort of aseptic example of Zurich Kloten. Kloten could work on its periphery. This is a weenie stand, one of the weenie stands that sells the most weenies in the canton. The streets, apart from that ecological rear, the streets with the brand new tram are appallingly sad and uninspiring. They could be part of a project. There are signs that kids enjoy rolling around the airport. All the ingredients are there, but somehow the will is not there to correlate the two. München Riem has a similar story. The planners thought that it was really much smarter to organize their urban plan on a north-south. Actually, the German language is probably the only language I know with a verb north, you north, ich norde, and to north. So the engineers, instead of taking these strange shapes, said, let's north. So they northed the runway. And this is the result. The main fairground housing, and this is where Gilles Wexler tried to struggle to go back to the original pattern that we talked about, but somehow constrained by the planning that had occurred. This is not a Photoshop picture, this is actually a photograph of the basin and the whole structure, sort of struggle. When you look at the plan, it's obviously a maximal development. The housing here, because it's so isolated from the rest of the city and the rest of the neighboring villages, has social problems as a model. And the park itself, because of that, has not really, even though it's the third biggest park in Munich and has cost 70 million euros to build, is not functioning at its fullest potential. Hellenicon, I've seen Philippe in the audience. I was even on the jury of Hellenicon. When I look at the recent development, talking about 3 million square meters of development, I lose a little bit the sense of the landscape in there, but Philippe will be probably more akin to explain that in the future. I think there's a real parallel between what we're seeing in these two cases. This is Riem during the Buga. This was, believe it or not, designed by a landscape architect, Christoph Valentin, trying to come together with Gilles Wexler, bringing all these elements together. But somehow, the plan, the sort of monolithic plan of putting all social housing, a very uniform, as if they hadn't read Jane Jacobs before, has led to real issues. Also, and in a way, that's part of the problem, the sort of guilt or distrust working with the older relics of the Tribune of the 30s, etc., has created a very ambiguous relationship to the traces that are there. And in a way, the new axes that Gilles Wexler has set connect back to places that don't really have meaning. And you create artificial topography in places that don't need artificial topography. So in a way, this park is opening up more a set of questions than actually a set of answers. I'm going to conclude here in sort of making a plea for recovering the avian myths. We took students to Kloten, even got invited. We were in one of those areas that had been plucked of its Solidago canadensis. And one project in particular struck us, the Savannah project by Dominique Guigui, who has her own office now in Zurich. She took an extreme case. I'm not going to show the video tonight. You're missing out on something. A very sensual video where Japanese tourists dream of Kloten because they make a perfume, a rare extract out of this vegetation. This notion of transforming that landscape into something sensual and appreciable, something cultural, something palpable. This is the plan that she did, which would probably give a heart attack to any ecologist. There's the airport with the Savannah project. And this is the elixir, this is the Savannah perfume, which Japanese tourists would pay a fortune to go there. I mean, we literally had actors lying down on the runways, etc. I won't go into all the details. The same thing happens with Tempelhof. I was in the jury of that competition too. I know Elke is going to talk about this project. What happened with Tempelhof? There was a project, there was a budget, and all of a sudden, politicians realized that the popular appeal of the existing field, the way it was overwhelming. This is the day when Tempelhof was open to the public for the first time, with swarms of people, thousands of people just going in and using the field in a completely open way, coming back into the sort of spirit of the apron, with or without airplanes. Very interesting to see also how the usages evolved, how kids would come in and fly kites or sail on rollers on those tracks. And it's really interesting to understand, at least for now, how Tempelhof is really a laboratory. Here you see kind of grungy Berliners sitting in the grass, but Berlin is about grunge culture. You all know that. You even have the vegetable freaks growing airport vegetables. And in a way, what I particularly like in this place of hope is there's a sort of return of the aviator. You know, who knows it? Maybe the tiger moths will reappear someday and we'll have flying ladies and men bouncing around the airfield. I think that last but not least, Schiphol has probably been the most successful example because the rules in the landscape are so stringent. You're 6 or 7 meters below sea level, and if you do anything wrong, you're dead. And the rules there are so strong that you cannot go beyond certain patterns of drainage and figures inscribed in the land. I took these pictures coming back from the Beemsterpolder, which is a real inspiration. This is a pre-Versailles, this is early 17th century polder, quadratic, probably inspired Descartes in a lot of his writings, where the cows and sheep disappear at infinity. I was inspired by this landscape, particularly also by these single rows of trees. And coming back to Schiphol, rolling down on the new A5 motorway, I was not there as a pedestrian, I was there as a driver, but I saw this airplane grazing in the polder. I saw an object within its realm, sort of accepting its realm, and the realm itself framing the object. There was a sort of, the contention would be that there was actually a sort of harmony between the hypermodern equipment there and its frame. And I just wanted to show you this as a sequence. I've blown up that picture just to show you how repetitive these poplar trees can be in the Dutch landscape and how our little airplane appears as a sort of beast along the A5. And for me, this is, in a way, a message of hope. I think that whether the airport is in use or in disuse, we should go back to the spirit of each place. I thank you for your attention.
So a big thank you to both of our speakers, Peter Gallison and Christophe Giraud. We have a little bit of time, or we're going to take some time until 8:30, and I would like to ask the speakers to come up to the podium. So I'd actually like to open this up to the audience. We've heard two very inspiring presentations, which I think will start us off very well for tomorrow. Meeting tomorrow at 9 o'clock. We've been in the region. We've been almost, you know, visited very far away places, but we've also zoomed in on very detailed spaces at the airport apron, for example. So, any questions, since we're not that open for time? Yes, please. There's a mic coming here.
Hi, I have a question specifically for Professor Gallison. Your presentation reminded me quite a bit about Paul Virilio's theory of the accident, where any invention produced by man is accompanied by a great number of accidents. And he quotes specifically like September 11th, for example. As we're developing these new scales of mobility, which have such a grand spatial presence and program, and we're developing new forms as well, how do we begin to think about this entire ecology? And it seems, like you said, with every accident, there's sort of a rush to accommodate that possibility. How can we sort of preemptively look at these new forms?
preemptively in a way that would avoid going through the stage of having the accidents in the first place? Or what
yeah, that's part of it. How can we start to envision those things?
Well, one of the reasons that, the underlying reasons we have these accidents is that we're constantly trying to create zones of intense concentration and centralization. And as soon as we do that, whether it's intersections or city centers or transportation hubs, for the airplanes, that means you have a concentration of airplanes coming to one space, and that's where the accidents predominantly happen. But it's also why we have terrorism around these hubs. And in other words, I think that the conditions that we have bought into for our large technical systems are also the conditions of vulnerability, whether they're vulnerable to political intervention or terrorist attack or accidents. So I think that we've, in a way, that it's not spurious that these things are connected. They're connected because the reasons that we've made these hubs is connected to the reasons that we have the accidents. And then the question is, when the accidents happen, how do we understand them? What do we lift from those? And not every industry is like the airplane or aircraft industry. I mean, for most of the world, every nuclear plant, for instance, is different. And we don't seem to learn anything from our nuclear accidents. I mean, we didn't learn anything from Windscale that prevented Three Mile Island or Chernobyl or Fukushima. Each of them is in a different domain. And one of the things that happens with airplanes is that there are a lot of 737s and 777s and all these other airplanes. And so it's tragic to say, but there's actually something that these accidents produce. Whereas I don't know that Fukushima actually produced anything in a change in the way we conduct ourselves. That's an exaggeration, but we don't learn as much as we should because each of these things is seen as a one-off, and every time an accident happens in that domain, there's a huge effort to say it's entirely isolated. It could never happen again.
David Pascoe. Yeah.
Well, I'd like to thank both speakers for marvelous introductions, but I have a point really for Christoph. The whole question of allegory and the allegory of Guassi I found amusing. But I think you've been a little bit harsh on Paul Andra, because he really did go back to the drawing board for the next terminals that he produced. And the terminals there are, in the form of fingers, and they, as it were, bring back the apron. The milking machine, as it's sometimes called by British writers, I mean, it was an attempt to reinvent the wheel in the form of a wheel, to create a hub and spoke. The tube was an important allegorical feature. But I mean, I think simply to see it in isolation from the rest of Roissy, which is very, very different, might be perhaps making the story a little bit too easy.
I don't think it's an easy story, but...
No, the allegory is, I mean.
I don't think any of the buildings at Roissy, maybe apart from the last one that's way out in the boondocks there beyond the tracks, I don't think any of those buildings offer a relationship to the apron. I disagree with you on that, but you're right. You have windows, at least, and you can look towards the outside. So I'll concede that.
Yes, Ed Eigen in the back.
Thank you, Sonia. This has to do with the question of borders and boundaries and limits, which I think is a connective theme to the two talks. And also the issue was addressed a moment ago by Professor Galison with regard to accident. And I think one of the virtues of accident is it unmakes a great inherited tradition, which is the kind of idea of the unities of time, place, and action. And Dryden tells us there are things that fall outside of these, being one of them being torrential rain. And which also, but then the virtue of the unities is that it gives us a frame for explanation. We can understand how things are cause and effect, and we can sustain a belief in the cause and effect and related. And this goes back to the question of limits then, because I was thinking about your example of why airports look the way we do, and they go back to the hijacking frenzy with the Palestinian Liberation Organization. And then the mathematics I was doing in my mind was, well, do airports look the way we do because the Palestinian Liberation Organization saw an air hijacking a spectacular way to pursue their political ends, such that airports look the way they do because of a problem with the partition plan in Palestine, which was done with a grease pencil, and we know all the problems of that, you know, which is, say, are certain terrestrial limits and divisions that were done in the 1940s now describing what airports look like in the 2000 whatevers. It's just a very, you know, I'm looking at this as a historian, how we draw these limits and territorial problems and how they're inscribed in these structures you're on top.
I wouldn't bring it down to such a simplistic level, but I think that's the trigger. The trigger, then the sort of internalization and the branding behind that, and the fact that airports are closing in on themselves, are a consequence of these prototypes that developed in the 70s and 80s. I'm talking as a landscape architect. I mean, I'm trying to explain why there was such a break in the relationship to the outside. To the terrace. Terraces were no longer accessible. You can even get on the roof of a building, etc., etc., etc. And I find that to be the case until today. And what has substituted is this shopping frenzy, you call it whatever you want, consumerist environment within airports that are highly valuable. I mean, in Zurich, the square meter of any shops there has skyrocketed in recent years. And what I'm simply saying is it's not inciting people to go outside again. We tried to say, well, passengers waiting for a while in the airport could go for a walk, you know, or for a jog, enjoy the outside. And what's really interesting in the marketing of Claughton, for instance, is they're marketing exclusively to the local population when it comes to the ecological path, and the passengers remain captive. And I think that's really part of the discussion. I'm not saying I have answers today. I'm just simply saying this seems to be the situation. There are probably more reasons than just PLO politics and all that and Al-Qaeda. What I'm saying, though, is they have contributed into restricting that dialogue between the inside and outside. That's how I see it. I can't explain it any other way.
You know, in a way, I think the accident functions for these large technical structures the way a social malfunction functioned for Durkheim. You know, when Durkheim says, what's a sociological fact? He said, well, a sociological fact is made visible when you try to use German currency in France and the bus driver says, I'm not going to take it. Then you know you're in the domain of the social. Well, accidents do something like that. They show us in a terrifying way that the system doesn't correspond to this utopian smooth function that we keep hoping that it will. And so, in a way, if you were looking for an analogy to it, it might be the early history of trains. You know, Shivel Bush's study of early trains. People were really frightened of going in a train. They were frightened by the accidents, they were frightened by the speed, they were frightened by the noise. The whole thing was a kind of awful experience, exhilarating in some ways, but awful in another. And I think that trains have been domesticated in some sense, even though there are still train accidents, but somehow people don't have the same fear of trains that they do. But flying does have a fearful aspect. And I think one aspect of the way a lot of the architectural features is designed to cover that fear, and the accidents sort of make it vivid, and then we have to ask ourselves these questions that in some ways we want an accident to be understood by something very local, you know, this wire malfunctioned on the left engine. And in other ways it's, you know, the whole biosphere around the region, or the way we test mechanical parts for safety, or the regulatory structure. I mean, So we have this, in every accident, there's this dual and contradictory impulse. One is to localize, to contain, to reassure. And the other is to say, the probable cause of this accident or all the things without which the accident wouldn't have happened, but that's as big as all outdoors. And so we, you know, I think that that's, you see that in each of these domains that I've been looking at. You know, we're going to pat you down, and we're going to invest in massive data mining activity that covers the world. We're going to look at the moles underneath the runway, and we're going to register the geese and pigeons and starlings all over a 50-mile radius from the airport. And all of the, you know, it's constantly this oscillation of scales because we're trying to account for, reassure ourselves, and remediate these moments of technological break.
I think we have time for one more question, if there is one. Yes, in the back.
Good evening. Thanks so much for the great talks. I have a question. I'm quite interested in the notion of proximity between the city and airports. And of course, there's a growing trend towards bringing airports outside of the cities, well beyond the edge, because of noise, land value, etc., and to link them with a kind of umbilical cord with high-speed train, etc. But in a lot of the examples you gave, like Tempelhof, especially, it's incredibly close to the city, and in that sense, it was very much an arena for, you know, the social, all these social aspects in Germany. So to what extent do you think that it's possible to have airports that are well beyond the edge of cities and still be locations of cultural production?
Is that a question to me? I mean, there's a very good example right now. I should probably shouldn't say that, but I'll say it anyway. The new airport in Berlin that's been located way out of town and has a few functional problems to date, as compared to Tegel, it's a real 1970s jewel of hexagonal thinking, not circular, but hexagonal. Those are real questions. I mean, I'm not totally sure whether that should be the case or how it could be. Transport, for one thing, is the main issue there, and also the sort of void around those new platforms. We have conflicts in France right now about a third airport happening in the west of the country, where the local population totally opposes that, even though it could be a motor of economic development. So I think that the question you're asking is multiple and rather difficult to answer in such a short time, but I think it's a valid question because that seems to be the trend, you know. I'm thinking of two places more particularly that have kept their airports in town, Buenos Aires, within a park designed by Thais, and Rio de Janeiro that has the old airport right in the middle of the bay. Mm-hmm. And you hear planes, they're a nuisance, but ironically, because of the Berlin Marx Flamingo Park there, and because the most expensive real estate is along that facade, and a lot of people there use the immediacy of the airport as an advantage, it hasn't been contested until now. So I think that those are real, I mean, it's almost a thesis in itself.
Well, actually, it was my thesis to some extent. But it was a design project for a city airport, but I investigated these issues and I never really came to conclusion. It's still kind of haunting me to some extent.
You know, it'll be interesting to see as these rural airports are put into place with a new vocabulary that's come more and more into prominence of environmental justice, for example, that people be, you know, about many things, not just airports, but begin to say that the people that benefit from something should bear the burden of it in terms of environmental impact. And although that's not the precise way it was framed, say, the big farmers' riots around Narita Airport in outside Tokyo and other places, I think that something under another name is what many countries are experiencing as people locally saying, we farm this land, you think it's valueless, this is for you, it's coming at a dreadful cost for us, and we're not content with that. So
Mirabelle,
I think that,
for example,
there's a, there are different ways that that can be phrased, but I, in more and more, in many other domains of technological imposition, of toxic waste dumps, of many things, there have been issues that have been framed around this vocabulary in the United States of environmental justice and have other names and other ways of being thought about in other countries.
Okay, thank you very much for your participation tonight. Okay. And I would like to thank our speakers again.